So the Whipple operation is actually the K2 of the mountaineering world. We can actually do a little bit more. It's pretty rare for us to choose to remove the entire pancreas, but we can, and I'm going to talk about, number one, why do we do that every once in a while? What do we do? Why do we do it? And what happens? In the Whipple, Dr. Lee told you about removing this portion of the pancreas. Sometimes we do that and remove the rest of the pancreas simultaneously. That's a total pancreatectomy. Sometimes we remove the Whipple and then later. We have to come back and remove the rest of the pancreas for any number of problems, but the most feared obviously being another pancreatic cancer in the remaining part of the pancreas, and sometimes we go the other way. We've taken this portion out, and we ultimately have to take the rest out, usually for the same problem. It's all of the operation that Dr. Lee described, and then some. One thing it does is it avoids having to make the connection between the intestine and the pancreas, and so there is, in fact, a lower chance of complications, and in particular, the feared complication, leakage of pancreatic juice from that connection. So it's a bigger operation overall. We're taking out more stuff, but in some ways, it might actually be a little bit safer because of the avoidance of that high-risk connection. So that's what we do. Why do we do it? Either it's for a cancer that is sort of right smack in the middle of the pancreas, and we can't start at one end and preserve enough pancreas to make it meaningful, or it's actually to try to prevent pancreatic cancer. There are a number of conditions, and Dr. Castrinos is going to tell you a lot more about the genetic preconditions that give rise to pancreatic cancer. There's also this disease called introductal papillary mucinous neoplasia. It's sort of like ERCP. IPMN is what we call it. And this is the frequency that we in our center have done operations for IPMN. And the goal of IPMN surgery is actually to operate on people before they get pancreatic cancer. Now, most of the time, we remove a portion of the pancreas, not the entire pancreas, but there are people in whom we remove the entire pancreas because the whole thing is affected, and we consider the entire pancreas at risk for developing pancreatic cancer. Currently, about a third of our operations in the Pancreas Center are done for IPMN. Now, some of those come back malignant, and the proportion that are malignant has been relatively constant over the last several years. So we're not quite perfect at identifying this and getting it out before it becomes malignant. But many of these diagnoses we arrive at serendipitously. Somebody has a kidney stone, goes into the emergency room, has a scan, and whoops, there's a pancreatic cyst, and then we need to figure out, is that a meaningful diagnosis in terms of cancer risk or not? But the good news is that we're doing a lot of surgery today to prevent pancreatic cancer. So that's why we do it most of the time, is prevention. And then finally, what happens? I often have people tell me that I can't remove the entire pancreas, and I say, well, you know, I beg to differ. I do it every once in a while, and in fact, people do pretty well. The important question from the patient perspective is, you know, how often do you get through the operation, and what's the quality of life after the operation? Well, by definition, you have to become diabetic. The pancreas does two main things. It makes insulin and some other hormones. The other hormones you notice less, and digestive enzymes, obviously. People need to take both digestive enzymes and they need to take insulin. There's no diet-controlled diabetes in this setting. You have to take insulin. And you have to, as Roy will tell us in a moment, you have to be pretty compulsive about it. It's not just your standard run-of-the-mill diabetes. But there have been a number of studies looking at what happens to people who've had total pancreatectomy, one from the Mayo Clinic, which on average their patients were taking 14 enzyme capsules per day. On average, they were taking 32 units of insulin per day. These are people who were long-term survivors. The average was 7.5 years after their total pancreatectomy. And the hemoglobin A1C is a really important marker. It sort of looks at the average blood sugar over the prior month that the patient's system has been experiencing. And in this group of patients, the average hemoglobin A1C was 7.4%, with normal being under 7. Most diabetics don't get to a hemoglobin A1C of 7.4%. So most of the 80 million diabetics in this country don't achieve such good results as this. So their group of total pancreatectomy patients were coached well and took good care of themselves, obviously. A group in Switzerland, Dr. Buechler, similarly looked at a group of patients who underwent total pancreatectomy and compared them to patients who had a Whipple operation. They had comparable quality of life measures, and their group of patients had a hemoglobin A1C of 7.3%. Now, you'd expect the Swiss to be compulsive, so you would really expect this, right? Can we do it in New York? This is a study of patients who agreed to be followed after total pancreatectomy here at the Pancreas Center. And we compared them to a group of patients who were matched in every way, who underwent a Whipple operation. And no question that their diabetes indices were worse on essentially all of these scales. Many of the Whipple patients didn't become diabetic, and so we have to say that total pancreatectomy is a worse operation than a Whipple operation, and that's why we don't do total pancreatectomies if we can treat the patient with less than a total pancreatectomy. But when we look more globally, and in particular, these are quality of life scores comparing the Whipple patients with the total pancreatectomy patients, these numbers over here tell us whether the findings on these quality of life scores are actually different. The closer that number is to one, the less difference there is. We don't scientifically accept that there's a difference until this number goes down to 0.05. So any scientist looking at this chart would say that the quality of life of people undergoing total pancreatectomy is virtually identical to the quality of life of people who've had a Whipple. It's not normal, as Bob just told you. It's not normal if you've had a Whipple, but it's manageable. Your quality of life is okay. And I'm hoping that Roy Albertalli will convince you of that. Roy, can you try to convince people that it's okay?